3 books, 100 million sales.
But it also has sexual scenes that are intertwined with a love or romance story.
Porn has gone mainstream.
That doesn't mean that it's not just as dangerous as typical pornography would be.
Pulling back the shades on 50 Shades of Grey.
You're taking withdrawals from the bank of intimacy in your marriage.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Good morning and welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Every year, millions of Americans view pornography. And while many expect that most of these are men, nearly a third are women. These past few weeks, many women and fans of erotica flocked to the movies to see the big screen adaptation of 50 Shades of Grey. It's become one of the fastest selling R-rated movies of all time, creating a new genre called mommy porn. And many of the women who are watching it are asking an interesting question. Is it pornography or a love story? Take a look.
What happens in the bedroom stays in the bedroom. Or at least that was before we met Mr. Grey. Since its release in 2011, 50 Shades of Grey has captivated readers all over, with the first book setting the record for fastest-selling paperback of all time. 4 years, 100 million plus copies, and 52 translations later, the series has bedded the big screen. But not everyone is spellbound. For many, this erotic phenomenon is merely a glamorized excuse for porn. And as researchers tell us, STDs, divorces, and sales for restraints are on the rise, many argue that the fictional romance is anything but fictional, let alone romantic. Some call it empowering. Others call it degrading. Some say love story. Others say glorified abuse. In the end, only one thing is certain. For every shade of gray, there's an opinion. And who's to say what is right and what is love? And is all this drama really thanks to a little fan fiction? Or is there something shadier going on?
Well, recently our chatter, Jessica, wanted to get answers to some of those questions, so she sat down with psychologist and author, Dr. Juli Slattery. Let's take a look.
Juli, thank you for being with
Thanks
us.
Thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you. Well, 50 Shades of Grey is a blockbuster film, and the books flew off the shelves, but it's also an erotica film. Explain to us about erotica. What is that?
Well, erotica is typically viewed as a kind of literature. So 50 Shades of Grey started with 3 books, and that's part of why it has that term. But it also has sexual scenes that are intertwined with a love or romance story. So it's kind of like connoting that it's, you're not just looking at pictures on a screen like typical pornography might be, but that you're involving a love story as well.
So is there a difference between erotica and pornography?
Erotica just sounds better, doesn't it? I think it sounds safer, but in reality, like the world even calls erotica mommy porn. So it's kind of like a softer form of pornography that again has a love story wrapped around it. But that doesn't mean that it's not just as dangerous as typical pornography would be.
And you say in your book that pornography and erotica make sex emotionally unsafe. What do you mean by that?
Well, basically what erotica and porn do is they train you to be sexually excited by somebody other than your partner, other than your spouse. So in other words, if a man is looking at internet porn and he's with his wife physically, mentally, and spiritually, and emotionally, he's not with her. And the same is true of fantasy or erotic books that women would get involved with. And so at the end of the day, you have two people that might be sharing their bodies, but they're not sharing anything else.
You find that books, you know, these Harlequin books and the romance novels and erotic films, you know, they offer a lot of short-term excitement.
Yeah.
But what about the long-term ramifications? Is it damaging? Is it possible to incur long-term damage from reading these books or watching these movies?
Absolutely. Even the secular world, all the research in my field of psychology talks about the danger of pornography, and that includes erotica, that includes mommy porn. But what it does to the brain is kind of like, you know, if my kids woke up every day and they wanted candy for breakfast. Candy tastes good and be easy for me as a mom to say, well, at least they'll eat it. But what it does is spoils their appetite for the things that will give them nutrients. And that's what happens with pornography or erotica. It's this counterfeit intimacy that in the moment seems to spice things up, seems to get the motor running. But what it does is spoil your appetite for true intimacy in a marriage, true intimacy in relationship, and really ultimately true intimacy with God.
And for the married couple who's watching, they say, look, we're married. Can we read the book together? Can we go and can we see the movie together as a way to spice up our love life? What would you say to them?
I would say don't do it. You know, first of all, because God says to keep the marriage bed pure. But again, also from a psychological perspective, what you're doing is you're taking withdrawals from the bank of intimacy in your marriage. You're training yourself to look outside of your spouse for sexual fulfillment. We have a whole generation of men and women, married men and women, who can't sexually respond to their spouse because they've been feeding their brain on fantasy and pornography. You know, that's a tragedy that married men and women can't enjoy the gift that God has given them because they've been trading it for pornography and mommy porn.
You believe intrinsically every woman is designed for holy intimacy and a holy desire for true love and love in a pure sense, not in only the erotic and exciting sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's what we are designed for. Basically, our sexuality, our drive for romance, ultimately is rooted in a desire to know God. And God created sexuality to be a metaphor of His love and His covenant with His people. I guess I'd say it this way, every sexual choice is also a spiritual choice. You can't separate the two.
And you mentioned that in your book. You say that women can be both spiritual and sexual beings. Yeah. But I think that sometimes there's a shame culture around sexuality or talking about sexuality or asking questions. So what do you mean by that when you say that we can be both sexual and spiritual?
Well, I think you're right. There is really a shame culture around sexuality within Christianity. I think what we've done is build this huge wall between and the me who wants to love God and serve the Lord, and the me who is created as a sexual being. And most Christian women are sexual atheists. They live their life.
Wow, I've never heard that before. That's really interesting.
Yeah. Well, it's not my term. I remember reading about it. But we live our lives like, I want to please God in every area of my life. But when it comes to sexuality, you know, I kind of want to just do it my way. And God doesn't have a whole lot to say about it. And I think that's a big problem, and it's a big problem for married women.
Well, I have read your book, Pulling Back the Shades. It's a very fascinating book. I really enjoyed reading it, and it really serves as almost a handbook, I think, to churches who are saying, we don't know how to answer the tough questions or the embarrassing questions. And so what is your hope for women as they read your book, Pulling Back the Shades?
Mm-hmm. Well, Dana Gresh and I, who wrote the book with me, our hope, and we're dreaming and praying big, is for revival. You know, we're praying that God would use this movement of 50 Shades of Grey to wake up the church and to realize that our boundaries and our morality is gone. And our only hope is to ask the Lord to bring revival, you know, to bring healing, because sexuality represents for many women a lot of pain and a lot of shame, that they would seek the Lord for healing and that He would just pour His Spirit on us and revive His women for Him and for holiness.
That's wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Juli. It was a pleasure having you. The book Pulling Back the Shades is available nationwide wherever books are sold.
Well, Dr. Juli had some real insight there, Jessica. And particularly I found it interesting when she said, you know, that erotica and pornography trains the mind to go to someone else besides our spouse for intimacy.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I so appreciate that Dr. Juli, who is somebody, an expert in their field, a doctor, a psychologist, can come and say, listen, this is not healthy. It's not safe. You may have good intentions with these romance novels to try and spice up your love life. But really, there are long-term ramifications in the same way that there are long-term ramifications for engaging in pornography. And later in the show, you're going to hear prayer requests from people who have been involved in pornography, been involved in erotica, and even been involved in those things as a couple, and they have seen long-term damage because of that. So it was wonderful getting to interview her, and we hope that many people who are on the fence about whether to see movies like 50 Shades of Grey will really think twice.
Yeah, and that sexual atheism term she uses, very, very thought-provoking. Well, still ahead, she was young, and she was hooked.
I knew my dad had movies that he said that I couldn't watch. I began to raid his movie cabinet and would fast forward to any sex scene, adult scene that I could find. But that wasn't enough.
Find out what freed one teen from her pornography addiction. That's when we come back. Well, it's all too easy for a child to fall into pornography. And that was Crystal's story. To her friends and family, she seemed like the perfect kid. However, she had a secret that was consuming her.
Felt two very different feelings at the same time. One of shame, but then immediately with that, I felt kind of an odd sense of satisfaction, like this was filling something in me that was void. One day after school, I found in my brother's bathroom a pornographic magazine. And honestly, it was like nothing I'd ever seen before. I was almost scared. Like, am I to look at this? I was curious and opened the magazine up. And in that one particular moment, I was kind of thrusted into sex ed in a way that no child should ever be introduced. And it began at only the age of 10. But I knew I needed to find more of this. I began to look around my house a little bit. Like, is there anything here that could give me that same kind of high, that same kind of charge that that magazine did? I knew my dad had movies that he said that I couldn't watch. And so after school one day, I began to raid his movie cabinet and would fast forward through those movies to any sex scene, adult scene that I could find. But that wasn't enough either. At about age 13, my school had internet, and so I would stay after school. I would look up naked people or sex or whatever I could, whatever words I actually knew what the terms were for. And soon after that, you know, cyber sex led to phone sex. When I was 16, I began going to church with my mom and was given the opportunity to go to summer camp. I was actually terrified about going to camp. It meant 5 days without those things that I had been living with and living for. But somehow, some way, I made that decision to go. One night at the camp, the pastor said, "You have a Father in heaven who loves you and who loves you unconditionally." And to me, the idea of having a father who's always available, always there for me, a comforter, and who loves me unconditionally was something I really wanted to sign up for. And so that night at camp, I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, but my addiction did not leave me. When I got home, even though I had made that decision to follow Christ, I went immediately back into my old routine, even more so. And this time with even more shame, and now with a kind of conviction that I had never felt before. But it would be 2 years before I'd hit rock bottom. I am in a hotel room waiting for a person to arrive who I had arranged an anonymous encounter with on the internet. It's freezing cold, I'm shaking, just thinking, how did I get here? How did I get to this point that things are so detrimental, so destructive, that I'm allowing myself to be put at risk? I'm meeting somebody I don't even know in order to fulfill this high that I'm after. And in that moment, God just met me there. I heard his voice audibly for the first time in my life. And he said to me, "Crystal, I have so much more for you than this life you're living. Trust me and give this to me right now." And in that same moment, there's somebody at the door knocking, and I know who it is, and I know that I have a choice to make in that moment, to either trust God and allow him to take this from me, or open the door and I give myself away. I made the choice to trust God and just surrender in that moment and say, Lord, if you're really here, then take this from me. Give me a way out. And he did. The person at the door left, and soon after I did as well. I still didn't know how to come clean. I didn't know how to break free from this by myself. And so I just prayed, God, please bring somebody into my life who I can tell this to, or who will tell me something like this. Because at that time, I felt like I was the only one in the world, the only female in the world that could possibly be struggling with pornography. One week later, I was at a concert when I came across a woman who I'd only known as an acquaintance before this. We began to tell our stories, to share kind of our lives with one another. She said to me, you know, Crystal, I used to have a problem with pornography, and I was able to find freedom from that. I found victory in that. And you could probably see my face turn even whiter than it already is. And I said, me too. And from that moment on, I was engaged in an accountable relationship with her, but not only with her, but with God, fully surrendering not just the behaviors I was involved in, but the longings of my heart to Him. And I'm now 7.5 years sober, and I'm thankful every day that God meets you in the darkest places, in the hardest places, and He does provide you a way out, and He does provide you with help and hope.
Maybe you're like Crystal and you're saying, how did I get to this place? You're a man or you're a woman with a pornography addiction, living in darkness. You know, Jesus wants to call us into the light so He can put a light before our feet and guide our steps. And pornography is an addiction of darkness. And I was reading in the 5th chapter of John recently, in which Jesus was in Jerusalem, and there was a pool there where the blind and the lame and the paralyzed used to go. They would go there looking for grace and mercy and for healing. They thought the waters could heal them. You know, the blind and the lame and the paralyzed represents what pornography can do to us, the sin of pornography. It makes us blind to the love and the grace and the compassion of God. It makes us lame, unable to find the strength to walk in God's ways. And it paralyzes us. How can I conquer this alone? Jesus went to that place, and there was a man there who had been an invalid for 38 years. And Jesus picked him, of all people, the most pathetic, the most hopeless, and asked him a question. He said, do you want to get well? And perhaps many thought that was a naive question. Who wouldn't want to get well? But Jesus wanted this man to think of it. Do you want to be well? And I ask you today, do you want to be well? Do you want this addiction behind you? If so, know there is hope. There is hope. You have an enemy, the devil, who wants nothing more than to destroy your relationship with God. That's his goal. Pornography is a way to do that. And I'm sure if you have a pornography addiction, you're feeling that. It destroys relationship with God. And the enemy wants to tell you you are too unclean, too sinful for Jesus to accept you. That's a lie. That is a lie. Jesus does not wish to add to your shame. He does not wish to humiliate you. He desires to restore you to friendship with God. He's here to rescue us. And you know, if someone needs to be rescued, there's a key to it. If you fall overboard and people on the ship throw you a life raft, you can cling to it, but they're not going to leave you where you are. To be rescued, you have to be pulled in. For us to allow Jesus to rescue us, we not only accept His love, but we do what He asks us to do, which is simply follow. Follow Him. Focus on Jesus Christ and His love and compassion and grace and mercy, and stop focusing on the darkness and the sin and the shame. That is a trick of your enemy, to destroy your relationship with God. But Jesus, who had a dear friend, Peter, who denied even knowing Him, Jesus restored that friendship. He desires friendship with you. In order to come out of the darkness, I encourage you to pray with someone. I encourage you to give us a call at 888-777-1999. You don't need to give us your name, your email address, your phone number, nothing. Just call and say, I have an addiction to pornography. I need help. I need someone to pray with me. Understand, Jesus desires friendship with you no matter the shame in your life. Coming up, we're going to be praying for you. But first, a human sex trafficking victim escapes and finds a home. Find out how. That's next. Shanu was only 8 years old when she was forced into prostitution. At 16, she was rescued from sex slavery, but her security was soon threatened again.
Shanu lives in Mumbai, India. When she was 8 years old, she was forced into prostitution.
They robbed me of my dignity. I felt like my heart turned to stone. I was helpless.
Then when Shanu was 16 years old, an organization called Bombay Teen Challenge rescued her from the streets. They provided her with a safe place to stay.
I learned about Jesus here. He renewed my life.
But this safe house had a major problem, a severe water shortage.
They used to bring water tankers. We would fill our buckets, carry them to our rooms, and store the water in a large drum. But sometimes the water truck would not come. It was very difficult.
Without enough water, the home would be forced to shut down. So Operation Blessing came in and dug three wells. Now there's enough water for the 275 children who live here.
Now we get plenty of water from the wells. We don't have to carry our buckets anymore. I can bring water to my room anytime. I'm so happy for that. Thank you, Operation Blessing. When we were in need, you people came and helped us. Thank you so much.
You know, you read the news and you see so much discouraging news going on and so many horrible things happening. You think, what can I do? What can I do to help? One of the great things is you can partner with what we're doing here at 700 Club Interactive and make a difference around the world. And it's so simple to do. Just give us a call at 888-777-1999. Even easier, you can log on to cbn.com and you can make a difference in the lives of so many. Well, we here at 700 Club Interactive want to pray with you. So let's go over to Jessica.
Well, Andrew, we've got lots of prayer requests that have come in on this topic. Steve says, I'm a sex addict. I started at a young age with porn and it has been going on for over 20 years. I don't know what to do or how to stop. Please pray for me. I want God to take this addiction from me. Ginger writes in, I read an erotic book and now I can't stop thinking about it. I didn't see anything wrong with reading the book initially, but now it's influencing me. I'm having sexual thoughts and fantasies about men that are not my husband. Please pray that God will take these thoughts away. And finally, Shannon writes in, my husband and I used to look at porn together. At first, it helped our marriage. Now my husband no longer engages in porn, but it has become an addiction for me and I can't stop. Please pray that God will take this away. It's ruining my marriage. Well, we are going to pray for you. And if you are watching and you are struggling with reading erotic literature or pornography, know that there is hope for you. And we're going to pray for you now. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God. We thank you, Lord, that you are so faithful, God, that we can come to you with our sin and our filth. And God, we can just know that we don't have to clean ourselves up before we come to you, but God, that you embrace us. Father, that you love us and that you take this sin and the addiction from us and give us the freedom that we could not achieve on our own. So, Father, right now we lift up Steve and Shannon and her husband and for Ginger. And God, we ask that you deliver them right now in Jesus' name. Father, we ask that they will come clean to accountability in their lives, whether that's to a pastor or to a friend or to a counselor or someone who that can hold them accountable, Lord. Father, we ask for freedom. We ask for biological freedom, Father, from the addiction that just wants them to keep going back to it. Father, for the emotional wounds that need to be healed, for the restoration in marriage. Lord, we ask that you would come and that you would set them free for once and for all. Lord, that your power, the power of your blood would come and would cover them and completely deliver them. Father, that their testimony will be a great inspiration to those who are struggling with the same thing. And for those wondering, can I be free? The Lord says, yes, today you will know that you can be free and to stay strong and to walk with Him and in His strength and in His power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Andrew?
Amen. Thank you, Jessica. Remember, you can call us anytime, 888-777-1999, and we are here to stand with you in prayer for whatever you are facing. And remember, too, that Jesus desires to restore friendship with you. Do not stay stuck in the shame of sin. Realize Jesus wants nothing more to embrace you and to tell you He loves you. We leave you with these words from Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. So put to death the sinful, earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. For Jessica, I'm Andrew Knox, and we'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive.